Simon & Schuster Audio. The Motley Fool's Rule Breakers, Rule Makers, The Foolish Guide to Picking Stocks. Written and read by David and Tom Gardner. Many things having full reference to one consent may work contrariously. As many arrows, loosed several ways, fly to one mark. As many ways meet in one town. As many fresh streams meet in one salt sea. As many lines close in the dial center. So may a thousand actions, once afoot, end in one purpose, and be all well born without defeat. Henry V, Act 1, Scene 2.
In the character of King Henry V, William Shakespeare gave to world literature one of its brightest military heroes. Henry's the young king who charges across the English Channel, wins a shocking upset, and becomes heir to the French throne. He achieves these things by his eloquence, his guts, and his love of his men, all of which Shakespeare renders evocatively and, as always, quotably.
If you went back a couple of plays, however, you'd see another side of Henry. Henry IV, Part 1, introduces us to Prince Hal, a dissolute youth who whiled away his days hanging out with scapegraces and ne'er-do-wells at an East Cheap tavern. But from this acorn one could nevertheless envision the tall oak that would one day sprout. Prince Hal's love of fun, for instance, would come back as Henry's battlefield daring. And the low company he kept provided him with the common touch that he expertly applied as he led his men into the open ground between two woods that was Agincourt. Even though the young Prince Hal takes an unorthodox approach to princeship, he nevertheless knows what he was about, as he states in Henry IV, Part 1.
I know you all, and will a while uphold the unyoked humor of your idleness. Yet herein will I imitate the sun, who doth permit the base contagious clouds to smother up his beauty from the world, that when he please again to be himself, being wanted, he may be more wondered at.
By the end of the play, Hal is indeed pleased again to be himself. He emerges, in fact, as a hero through his defense of his father's kingdom from rebellion at the Battle of Shrewsbury, and by slaying his audacious rival Hotspur. And in so doing, Prince Hal reasserts himself as the true heir, in both blood and temperament, to the English throne. He is the rule-breaker ascendant. The comic irresponsibility that was so much a part of his charm early on has been replaced by an equally charming graciousness and generosity demonstrated by his willingness to allow his foolish old friend Falstaff to claim the credit for vanquishing Hotspur. By Henry V, Henry the Rule Breaker has become Henry the Rule Maker. He leads his men through his eloquence and his example, each by turns tender and brutal. Shakespeare's Henry is the best metaphor we could find for the precept set forth in this audiobook, because he begins as a rule breaker, Prince Hal, and becomes a rule maker, King Henry V. And that journey, in a different context, is what this audiobook is about.
This audiobook is about rules, how they are made and how they are broken. In the business world, every industry has its rules, determined by the industry leaders. In order for a new business to come into existence and gain significance, it must consciously break those rules or be doomed to follow them, ever the pawn on someone else's chessboard. To survive and prosper, entrepreneurs, therefore, invent new rules or change the game altogether. Out of these efforts come competition, capitalism, innovation, and improvements in the standard of living. All great businesses begin by being rule breakers.
After a company has broken the rules, it enters into a middle stage, becoming what we term a tweener. Tweeners ultimately face one of two mutually exclusive identities. The best achieve sufficient speed, size, efficiency, and scope to usurp the throne and make the rules in their industry. These are the rule makers. However, sadly, the vast majority of tweeners do not manage to make the rules. Their failure may come quickly, or it may come after many years of almost becoming rule makers.
Investors can reap raging returns by investing in rule breakers, young companies that hold out the possibility of copious money-making as they drop down onto the chessboard and suddenly, outrageously, put the king in check. In so doing, these upstarts also place themselves in danger of being quickly eliminated, which means that investors and rule breakers take extreme risk. But extreme risk can bring extreme reward. Investing in rule breakers, great companies at their infancy, is the subject of the first half of this audiobook. It was written by me, David Gardner, so I will be so bold as to read the part.
Investors can also reap royal returns by investing in rule makers, playing the kings for profits as regularly and lucratively as medieval kings used to tax their own people. Investing in rulemakers involves substantially lower risk and lays the foundation for a lifetime of investing. Rulemakers make money at market-beating rates for years and years, like a toll booth or the taxman. Investing in rulemakers, which should always be undertaken before and then in addition to investing in rulebreakers, is the subject of the second half of this audiobook, which I wrote. I'm Tom Gardner, and I'll take you through that section. Before David goes into rule breakers, let me offer a couple of additional crucial introductory thoughts. First, the best investments of all involve buying a rule breaker and holding it all the way through to its becoming a rule maker and beyond. It only takes one of these in a lifetime to make an investor rich. And second, a lesson to all investors. Business is as simple as changing the rules at the beginning and then making the rules at the end. This is an audiobook about rules. It may sound like an investment guide, but it's also about business, and it may be about something deeper than that.
I say the earth did shake when I was born. Henry IV, Act 3, Scene 1.
As Darwin did before him, the celebrated Harvard paleontologist Stephen Jay Gould has made much ado, has filled whole books, actually, about one of our society's common misconceptions regarding evolutionary theory. Namely, the fact that many of us fallaciously view evolution as a process of continual improvement, as if our species, all species in fact, were engaged in a constant upward progression from less complex to more complex, from less intelligent to more intelligent, from weaker to stronger. Gould counters this fallacy by explaining that evolution doesn't necessarily entail the continued improvement of the thing evolving. To say that something is evolving simply means that it is continuing to adapt successfully to changing environments. Natural selection simply causes species to evolve in a way that best suits their given environment. It does not, by definition, result in species that are inherently and progressively smarter, faster, stronger, better. If you're wondering just what the heck this has to do with a business and investing guide, wonder no more. Consider this. Natural selection, the crucial driving force of organic evolution, is the cleanest metaphor I can think of for what drives success in business. And success is of utmost interest to business managers and long-term investors alike. In the context of this audiobook, what's being naturally selected aren't advantageous genetic traits, but the advantageous characteristics of a business model, or a strategic plan, and a workforce capable of dreaming up such plans and executing them. In business, the agents of natural selection are customers and their consumer needs. It is customers who naturally select businesses, and thereby cause industries and economies to evolve with time. The horse and buggy. Hello, Ford. The candle. Hello, Edison. The Iceman came, then... Hello, refrigerators. The Iceman went. How does this happen? Remember the fallacy that Stephen Jay Gould pointed out. Once successful companies that ultimately became unsuccessful believed in and focused on constantly improving rather than adapting. Their research and development money went to upgrade their existing products, and their marketing money was spent on promoting those products. They were always looking for ways to cut costs, and their competitive research was confined to the study of industry players who were playing the same game by the same set of rules. Companies like this are doing all the right things, but it may be the beginning of the end for them. In such circumstances, the original business solution that brought a company into being in the first place may suddenly be lost. But due to myopia, arrogance, fear, or sheer inertia, or a combination of these, the company is in too deep and can't turn back. It's going to take some naughty entrepreneur to come in and kick down the doors. And the one thing you can say for sure about capitalism is that this is exactly what will happen. Someone's going to start breaking all the rules. As an investor, you want your money riding on that entrepreneur. And as a businessman, you should aspire to be that entrepreneur. So let's start defining, locating, and illustrating these rule breakers.
Our hands are full of business. Let's away. Advantage feeds him fat while men delay. Henry IV, Act 3, Scene 2.
Even though he was known more as a master navigator and mariner than as an entrepreneur, if you study the life of Christopher Columbus, you'll recognize a fellow who had as much affinity for business as he had for sea charts and caravels. Indeed, the admiral of the ocean sea possessed the entrepreneur's sine qua non, persistence. After his adopted Portugal rejected Columbus's proposed exploration in search of the fabled Western Passage, he packed up his duds in 1485 and scooted over to Portugal's Iberian rival, Spain. Spain turned him down once, then twice, and maybe more times, we're not sure. But it wasn't until at least a third pitch session in April of 1492 that Columbus received his eventual thumbs up from Queen Isabella. In October of 1492, Columbus made his famous landfall in the West Indies and cruised along the coast of Cuba before heading home. Then over the next half century, the Spaniards established a huge empire in America and made their first settlements in East Asia. By 1550, Spain had become the undisputed power of the world. Before the 16th century ended, Spain would own Portugal. We may not find many better examples of true rule-breaking than Columbus's first voyage to the New World. What were the previous rules? How had things always been done? Well, you already know. Europe followed the trail of Marco Polo, conducting its trade overland to the east. Nobody had ever done things differently. You can just hear all the naysayers. Nobody had done things differently and survived. Anyway. No better analogy comes to mind for the first attribute we find in our corporate rule breakers, which we shall now introduce. A rule breaker is the top dog and first mover in an important emerging industry. Let's now break up that phrase into its constituent parts. First, top dog. Well, top dog simply denotes market leader, largest player, or what have you. To determine top dog, we typically evaluate public companies based on their market capitalization.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.